I know you've all come to listen to Alex Himelfarb tonight, and I promise we'll get there eventually. But I do have to say some thank yous, and we have some guests to speak as well before we get started. And I'd like to begin by acknowledging and thanking the generous sponsors who've made this conference possible. The Alberta Federation of Labor, Athabasca University, the Canadian Union of Public Employees, Civic Service Union Local 52, the Health Sciences Association of Alberta, the Non-Academic Staff Association at the U of A, the United Nurses of Alberta, always the loudest, the University of Alberta's Faculty of Arts, and the Woodsworth Irvine Socialist Fellowship Endowment. So yeah, a round of applause for all those sponsors. I'd also like to thank the media sponsors who support the conference and make it possible and help us get the word out about the conference to get people here. Alberta Views Magazine, and there's a whole crew of them again here this year. I understand they'll have some swag to give out over the course of the conference as well, some lovely tote bags. So if you want to check in at the Alberta Views table over the course of the weekend, I'm sure they'll set you up. View Weekly and CJSR Radio in Edmonton. And most importantly, I'd like to thank the many, many volunteers who've been helping us out at this conference and will be helping us out all weekend. Parkland can't thank all the volunteers enough. Without them, we really could not do this. We will be joined over the course of the weekend by a number of elected officials from the province, many of whom have been coming to the conference for years. I've been watching to make sure I was not missing anybody coming in. So far tonight, I've seen Cam Westhead, the MLA for Banff Cochrane, who is up there. If you want to stand up and wave, Cam. And if you see other folks come in tonight, please go up, say hi to them, thank them for having been here in the past and for being here again to take part in these important discussions and conversations. We do have a number of guests in the audience tonight that I just want to draw your attention to. You may have heard in the last week that Parkland, in partnership with the University of Victoria and the BC and Saskatchewan offices of the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives, have won a large Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council grant. This is truly a fabulous outcome. And it's resulted from the hard work of many, many people. In particular, I want to welcome tonight and introduce on this occasion the project's co-directors, Shannon Dobb from CCPA BC. Where's Shannon? At the back there. And Dr. Bill Carroll from the University of Victoria is also back there. Shannon and Bill, along with Simon Enoch from CCPA Saskatchewan and Parkland's own Trevor Harrison and Ian Hussey, make up the steering committee for this vast undertaking, and we're lucky to have all of these folks here with us tonight and over the course of the weekend. As you all know, Parkland Institute is proudly part of the Faculty of Arts here at the University of Alberta. We're very fortunate with the support we receive from the Faculty of Arts, and we're very proud of the role that we're able to play within the faculty. We have with us tonight Dr. Michael O'Driscoll, who's Associate Dean of Research, and I'd like to invite him to come up and bring greetings from the faculty.
Thanks very much, Ricardo, and we are fully proud of the Parkland Institute. Friends, colleagues, distinguished guests, I'm delighted and honored to join you this evening and to share in welcoming you to the University of Alberta and to the 2015 Parkland Institute Conference on Alberta and the Future of Canada. My name is Mike O'Driscoll. I am Associate Dean Research in the Faculty of Arts and a member of the Parkland Institute Board of Directors. I bring greetings from Acting Dean Lise Gotell, who unfortunately is unable to be here tonight. Since 1997, Parkland has held annual conferences that set the stage for broad public and scholarly conversations on issues and concerns that matter to Albertans and to Canadians. This major annual event is one among many activities carried out during the course of each year that put relevant and incisive research into the hands of concerned citizens, policymakers, journalists, academics, and other members of the public. Smart, thorough, nonpartisan, and timely information nurtures democracy, guides the struggle for social justice, and drives good policy and fair legislation. Parkland does this not only with commitment and integrity, but also with panache and swagger. And for that, we are grateful to Trevor and to Ricardo, to their team, to you supporters, to their sponsors, to everyone for the hard work and contributions that you all make. I need tell no one in this room that the province of Alberta is poised on the very precipice of possibility. The dramatic change in political fortune to which we've all been witness opens on to a broad vista of opportunities for a more vital democracy, a more just society, a more sustainable economy, a more prudent relation to the natural world. But as with any moment of transition, this is a fragile time. Finding our way forward not just to a better future, but as a leader of positive change in political economy, labor policy, Indigenous rights, climate stewardship, energy transition, education, poverty, healthcare, and all forms of wellness will demand careful, inclusive, and responsible deliberation. In her recent State of the Faculty address, Acting Dean Gotell spoke of the need to become an outward-facing Faculty of Arts that would turn to the community around us for dialogue, engagement, and support in a manner that demonstrates the crucial collaborative role that advanced education must play in the 21st century. The Parkland Institute exemplifies that ambition and provides a model to which we might all aspire. We are then grateful for your presence here tonight. Thank you for joining us here at the University of Alberta. I wish you all the best for this weekend's activities and for the future to come. Thank you.
Perhaps if my notes were as good as Michael's, I could be partly proud of the job I'm doing up here tonight. When I've done this in the past, and I admit I haven't done it in a few years, Trevor Harrison kind of put this on me tonight because he's lost his voice. So I haven't actually been up here to introduce the conference in a number of years. And in the past, when I would do it, I would always, at this point of the introductions, kind of wander into a story and, you know, drag it out for a bit and take a roundabout route. But I think tonight, I'm just going to be blunt. Part of the reason that Parkland is here, part of the reason we've been here for 19 years, part of the reason that we've had 19 conferences, part of the reason that we've been able to play a role in creating opportunity for transformation in this province is because of the support that we get financially from people around the province and around the country. We don't work without donations. We do not get core funding from anywhere other than the people who support us and the organizations they belong to. So I know you're all here. I know you all get our materials. I know you are all current donors or have donated in the past. If you're not, I ask you to please fill out a pledge form on your way out tonight or at some point over the weekend. Make a contribution to our work and make a contribution to the changing of the province. If you are already a donor and you're not able at this point to increase your contribution, I ask you to please talk to your neighbors, your relatives, your friends, anybody you can corner. Tell them what a great weekend you had at the Parkland Conference and how worthy a cause we are for support, because without it, we can't keep doing what we do. So thank you for your ongoing support. Couple more quick announcements. For those of you who haven't registered for the whole conference but are interested in coming to the rest of it, you can pick up a conference registration on your way out at the end of the night at the Parkland table. If you have any questions at all about the conference, ask one of our volunteers. There's lots of them wandering around. If they can't answer your question, they should be able to point you in the direction of someone who can. For those of you who love to tweet and are hooked on Twitter, we used the hashtag ParkConf for the conference. And if you're able to come tonight and might have to miss some other part of the conference, we are also live streaming webcasting. That's what all this is. The whole conference off our website, parklandconference.ca, so you can sit at home in your pajamas and watch it from there. Although there's nothing like being here in person. The theme for this year's conference, we started talking about it back in January, as we do every year, and then really fine-tuned it after the May 5th election here in the province. And what struck us is that it's been exactly 20 years since Trevor Harrison and Gordon Laxer brought together a bunch of academics and thinkers to write a book called The Trojan Horse, Alberta and the Future of Canada. Besides being an important catalyst for the creation of the Parkland Institute, that book signaled that we were in the midst of significant change in the province, that our political context had shifted significantly, and laid out what we might come to expect from Alberta and how that might impact the rest of the country. As you know, over the course of the last 20 years, much of what was highlighted in that book has come to play out. Now, 20 years later, we find ourselves once again on the precipice of significant change here in Alberta. So we thought, what better way to signal that change and take a look at the impacts it might have for the rest of the country and our political context here than to have a whole conference dedicated to looking at what's possible in this new reality in Alberta. To help us do that and deal with some of these larger questions, we have with us, we're very fortunate to have with us, Alex Himelfarb. He's a professor of sociology at the University of New Brunswick from 1972 to 1981. He joined the public service in 1981 and held a number of positions within the public service, eventually becoming the clerk of the Privy Council. In September 2009, Alex was appointed director of the Glendon School of Public and International Affairs at York University, a position from which he's since retired. And he's currently the chair of the Canadian Alliance to End Homelessness at York University. He's become one of Canada's foremost speakers and writers on questions of fair and progressive taxation and on what is possible in terms of changing our economic reality. So please help me welcome to introduce our conference and get us off on the right foot, Alex Himelfarb.
I have a speech. I'm delighted to be back in Alberta. I'm particularly delighted, more than partly delighted, to be here with Parkland. I mentioned to Trevor that on my way here, that can't hear me? I have a very strained relationship with microphones. Is this better? Well, for you maybe, but not for me. On my way here, the plane stopped in Calgary, and I was asked to do the Danielle Smith news talk show, which I did, talking about taxes. You'll be surprised to know there were some things I said she didn't agree with. I don't know what she was smoking, but as I was in line to get back on the plane, I was listening to the callers afterwards. Holy shit. You know, we may have entered the decade of possibility, but we are moving uphill. There is a long way to go. So, but as I was on the plane, I thought, man, I could use a dose of Parkland, and so I'm really delighted to be here. When Trevor first approached me to do this, we had a conservative government in Ottawa. We had a conservative government, or so-called progressive conservative government, in Alberta. And so I had a pretty clear idea of what I would do. I would do what I always did in Alberta. I would come in, Because I realized as I was thinking this through how much of everything I did was driven by anger and frustration and even a kind of sense of fatalism that things would never get better. And so I would come in, I would do my speech to say four or five negative things about what was going on in Ottawa, five or six negative things about what was going on in Alberta, gather up some like-minded people and go for a drink. That was my... So I thought I had it nailed, so I said, yes, now... Albertans and Canadians have voted for change. So I had to rethink this whole thing. What do we say now? So I've been watching the early signs in Alberta and Ottawa about what we can make of this change, what we can make of moving out of decades of darkness into decades of possibility. So I saw what was for me a kind of a timid first step progressive budget in Alberta, but positive noises, positive sounds, delivering some of the promises. Actually, some tax increases, end of the flat tax, some good stuff. Modest for old progressives like me, but hopeful. I think, how do I deal with hope, you know? Anyways, that's a separate issue. But so some hopeful signs. But then I watched the media, the National Post, the Jeffrey Simpson, just pile on to this modest step. Just pressure to, already people speculating, you know, whatever's wrong with the Alberta economy, it's not oil prices, it's not 40 years of tax advantage, it's not hollowing out government, it's not neglecting investment, no, it's not that. It's these NDP people who've been in here for an hour and a half who've done all this. Those taxes are already killing us and they haven't even been implemented. You're already seeing the pressure. You know, the article saying they should slow down on climate change and they haven't released their plan yet. And some real anger that they haven't attacked public services and public servants. You know, and frankly, I take great heart in their commitment to protect public service and public, that's a huge language change. But the message is clear. It's tough for NDP governments to make the changes that we all know are necessary. So then you watch what's happening in Ottawa is really interesting and challenging for progressives, kind of. People who are slightly more on the left, say, than others. You know, the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives invited me to give a talk on what does it mean for us to have a Liberal government in Ottawa. And what I discovered was that even those who voted NDP and Green, they had a kind of guilty joy about this new government. I mean, they knew they shouldn't be feeling joyful, but they were. And they wanted reassurance that was okay, you know? And the question is implicit, is it enough for a prime minister to be not Harper? And I think a strong case could be made that even if it's not enough, it's not a bad step. But putting that aside, because I don't want to get too partisan, by the way, I'm not partisan. I say that in every speech, and I don't even know whether I believe it anymore. But I'll put it this way. I have not committed to any party, but I have definitely not committed to one. So here you have this new government, and the first signals are pretty heartening. So they immediately dropped the policy that deprived refugee claimants of medical services that are essential. And I've got to tell you, that's right. My Canada, you don't deprive refugees of essential medical services. Their commitment to bringing in 25,000 Syrian refugees, that's a good thing in my Canada. that's exactly what we do to the people who are fleeing the enemies that we so readily point at, freeing the sort of the suffering that we readily point at. But if we really are serious about making a difference in that part of the world, how better can we make a difference than using this $25,000 as the first down payment in a real commitment to refugee settlements? That's a good thing. The cabinet was kind of exciting. Diverse. Parity is a good thing in my view. It's going to change the tone. There, as I mentioned to people in the car, there were no bald Jews, and that made me uncomfortable. But other than that, minimum I'd say too, but that may be a personal bias, but there were some really good signals. But you know, I warned my colleagues, and we should embrace that. We should support every one of those, the long form census. Kathleen, who's going to talk to you later, said, yeah, you know, you can build a progressive Canada around the long form census. Look how low our expectations have sunk. We are saved! Anyways, okay, a distraction. But today, I don't know how many of you have noticed, today there was a fiscal and economic update by the federal finance minister, the new federal finance minister. And surprise, surprise, the cupboard is bare. The deficits are huge, much bigger than anticipated. And what is that going to signal? It's going to signal pretty soon the same kind of pressure that the NDP government's facing here. People are going to say, we can't afford all your promises. And frankly, the big middle-class tax cut, I don't think we can afford that promise. But in any case, we can't afford all your promises. They're going to say that. They're going to say, if you want to make some of these commitments, then you better find other places to cut. So the pressure is going to be on them to be much like the governments that preceded them. So the question that we're asking at this conference became clearer to me as I was sorting out what does it mean to have these governments that present some possibility for change, but no guarantees of change. So the question for me became, how do we break out of the austerity trap? How much change can we expect when we're still in the straitjacket of austerity? And we are definitely still in the straitjacket of austerity. Now, how many of you know what I mean by austerity? Just to give you my own personal definition, austerity is the belief that whatever the problem, the solution is cutting government services. If the problem is inflation, the solution is cutting government services. If the problem is slow growth, the solution is cutting government services. If you've had a bad cold, the solution is cutting government services. And if now we haven't had austerity, say, like Greece has had, or Spain, or even the UK, but make no mistake about it, we have had austerity, and we've had austerity for three decades. The size, you know, when I first came into government in the 1800s, when I first came into government, political scientists and social scientists described Canada as a public enterprise country. We had more trust in government than our neighbors to the south, that we believed in collective enterprise. We had crown corporations. We owned Petro-Canada. We owned rail, air. We were a public enterprise society. Our government, our federal government as a portion of the economy was bigger as a portion of the economy than the American government, even with all their defense spending, because we believed in collective enterprise. Do you know that today our federal government as a portion of the economy is smaller than the American federal government? Did you know today our federal government is projected to be to hit lows as a proportion of the economy that we haven't seen for 70 years, before we had Medicare, before we had public pensions, before we had mass education? We have shrunk government.
federally and provincially. And we have done it in small increments. That many of the audiences I speak to and the radio audience I spoke to today think government's still too big. Now, some of the pundits who praise the Harper years say his biggest accomplishment was invisibly and quietly and incrementally shrinking government, and he certainly has done that. But I actually think his biggest accomplishment is making us think that's a good thing. His biggest accomplishment is that we all accept that that's a good thing. So that's what I want to talk about. I want to talk about the price of austerity. Now, what I'm going to do, you know, they've given me an awful long time to speak. I do have a speech. They've given me an. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to. You will have heard the bottom line. So I'm going to give you the punchline, and then I'll do the build up as you're dozing or talking among yourselves. Conclusion number one. Austerity is toxic. Austerity is poison. Austerity kills. Earlier this year, about 400 psychoanalysts and psychologists in the UK got together and did an open letter. I don't know how many of you have seen this, an open letter that was published in The Guardian. And their argument was, austerity is toxic. What they said was that the people that they were seeing now, their problems had fundamentally changed over the last decade. The people were coming to them saying, I don't know how I'm going to make it from day to day, from week to week, from month to month. I don't know how I'm going to take care of my kids. I don't know what I can do. I don't know what I'll do when I lose my job, and I believe I'll lose my job. I don't know how I can deal with these unlivable working circumstances, but I have no choice. I don't know how to carry on. They listed all of this, and what's worse, all of these people, not all of these people, the vast majority blamed themselves. They had learned that they were responsible for their own poverty, that they were responsible for their own misfortune, that they were responsible for their own, that they had to take responsibility. They were being crushed. Austerity is toxic. It's toxic. People in Greece and Spain have killed themselves by the thousand, and it's documented, because austerity is toxic. Did I mention that I thought austerity was toxic? And it's toxic in more profound and collective ways. It's toxic to our sense of solidarity because it divides us, one against the other, public workers against private workers, region against region, rich against poor. It undermines solidarity in any sense of common citizenship. It's toxic to our democracy. And I'll talk a little bit about that later. And it's even toxic to the economy. It undermines our economic growth. It undermines our economic potential for the future. It is toxic in every possible way. If you take nothing else from this, take from this, austerity is toxic. And I don't like it. Conclusion number two. Austerity limits our sense of what's possible. Austerity lowers our expectations about the future. I don't know how many of you know about Joe Overton, a right-wing political scientist in the United States who coined the term the window of possibility in political science. It's now called Overton's window. What he says is at any given time, there are only a few things in the window that most of us think are politically possible. So, 10 years ago when I was in government, the Liberal government that ended up passing legislation to embrace same-sex marriage, that same government voted a resolution that marriage was always between a man and a woman. And the idea that you could embrace same-sex marriage 10 years ago was not in the window. It was not in the window. A whole lot of the things. Now, when I came to government, we used to talk about things like this, like social justice. There are blank stares. You haven't heard that, those two words just put together that way, right? Social justice, greater equality, human dignity. Those used to be in the window. They're out of the window. What austerity has done, it has shrunk the window very narrowly so that we have lost confidence that we can do anything great together. We've lost confidence that governments can do much of anything, even keep their own promises. We've lost trust in one another. We've lost trust in governments. We've even lost trust in the private sector. Austerity has shrunk our sense of what's possible. Now, I mean, there are a lot of reasons for that. People my age, middle age, older people my age, we've sucked the marrow out of this. We have sucked the marrow out of this country. We have done awfully well. We have benefited greatly. And we are, most of us, more interested in holding on to what we've got than building something new. We are managing decline. We are managing. The young people have grown up with government backing away from them. They don't know what government's capable of. They haven't seen government acting on their behalf and in their interest. And they too feel like they're managing decline. We're, for the first time in living memory, we take for granted that our kids won't have it as good as us. And we accept that. How the hell do we accept that? Shame. But austerity has made that seem not only acceptable, but inevitable. We have to break that straight. Frankly, we can afford the Canada we want. We can afford the Alberta we want. Our economy is $2 trillion. $2 trillion. It is bigger by far than the economy that allowed us to build Medicare in the first place, that built the social safety net. How is it that this $2 billion economy doesn't allow us to ensure opportunity, good jobs, and reasonable prospects for the next generation? How is it possible that a $2 trillion economy can't take care of the environment? How is it possible that in a $2 trillion economy, we no longer talk about social justice and equality? So conclusion two, it limits our sense of what's possible. And conclusion number three, it is not inevitable. It is a choice. It is the result of a series of policy choices. When in 2009, just before he was elected Prime Minister of the UK, Prime Minister Cameron gave a speech to his Conservative Party in the UK, and he announced that the UK, as the rest of the rich world, were entering the age of austerity. He actually coined the phrase, "We are entering the age of austerity." And he said it with far too much glee, but he pointed to the profligate spending of the previous Labour governments, the huge deficits, the huge debt, and he said, bringing back the old Margaret Thatcher phrase, there is no alternative. We have no choice. There is no alternative. That was the message. That was the message when Thatcher gutted unions. We have no choice. That was the message when Thatcher said we had to take government away from controlling, taxing and regulating entrepreneurs and businesses. We have no choice. We have to let the invisible hand of the market do its work. I think it was Joseph Stiglitz who said, you know why the invisible hand of the market is invisible? Because it doesn't exist. Or I prefer what Himelfarb said, is that even after 2008, when the invisible hand showed us the invisible finger, we didn't wake up to that reality. In any case, so we've heard for 3 decades that we have no alternative. Now, it's interesting, that was 2009, and we have no alternative, and used the huge deficit. The deficit was largely attributed to a financial meltdown that was a result of neoliberal policies of deregulation. But he used that deficit that was a result of the financial meltdown and bailouts to justify more neoliberal policies. It's kind of ironic and a bit horrifying. Now step back to 2006. So 2006, we elect a government that believes, like Cameron does and like Thatcher did, that we have to reduce government's footprint, right? That we have to make government smaller. But they have a huge problem. You know what their problem was? They inherited a surplus. They inherited a $14 billion surplus, the 10th consecutive surplus delivered by the federal government. So how do you justify these draconian cuts when you have a big surplus? Cameron had the benefit of a deficit. Now, thank God, you know, I have a deficit, right? So what does a prime minister like Harper do with the $14 billion surplus who wants to reduce government? What does he do? So he cuts 2 cents of the GST. You know how much 2 cents of the GST is worth? $14 billion. $14 billion surplus. $14 billion cut to the GST. All right. Deficit, here we come. That was before the meltdown in Canada. That was before the recession. We were headed to a structural deficit. Now, you have to understand, austerity isn't the result of tax cuts. Austerity is the purpose of tax cuts. Tax cuts are taking us on the road to austerity. That's their purpose. But if we chose this by voting for every tax cut that was on offer, we can choose an alternative. There is an alternative. You know what the alternative to austerity is? Not austerity. Let's build a better society. Let's renew our collective commitment to social justice, environmental justice. Let's renew our commitment to end child poverty and to address all poverty. Let's renew our commitment to greater equality. Let's renew our commitment to generational equality and to make sure that we don't have a lost generation of people who leave universities with extraordinary debt only to take precarious jobs with no prospects and few benefits. So we have a job to do. But before we go there, it's probably worthwhile. How am I doing on time? Oh, I got 3.5 hours. If we're going to get out of this, if we're going to break out of the straitjacket, if we're going to break out of the constraints of austerity, then we have to understand a little bit about how we got here, right? And we have to recognize the path that got us here. And I think a huge part of that story, as I've already suggested, is the story of taxes. The huge part of that story is the story of tax cuts. You know, I talked about Harper in the year 2006. There was no great fiscal pressure to cut government. We obviously didn't have a spending problem if we were producing a surplus. We weren't spending more than we were taking in. Indeed, you could say we had a spending problem. The spending problem was we weren't spending enough on infrastructure. We weren't spending enough on Aboriginal justice. We weren't spending enough on remediation. And we certainly weren't spending enough on youth and education. So we had a spending problem, but it wasn't the spending problem that Harper portrayed that is too much. Our spending problem was too little. But was there a compelling reason to reduce taxes? In the year 2000, the previous government, the Liberal government, I was working for that government, cut taxes in the year 2000. They cut taxes at the amount they cut was a historic cut, the biggest cut in Canadian history in the year 2000. $100 billion over 5 years from 2000 to 2005. Capital gains, corporate taxes, income taxes. So Harper came in when taxes had already been cut by $100 billion. Now, do you know how much total tax the Conservative government has cut per year? This, and I'm talking just federal, because every province, I mean, your Premier Klein did a job on taxes. That's called the tax advantage, an advantage that flows up to the rich, and what trickles down is just meanness. The $45 billion a year the federal government cut taxes after this $100 billion, $45 billion a year. That's real money. That's real change. Imagine how what we might think in this room would be possible if even some portion of that were still in the Treasury. Now, I was at a dinner party where somebody said, we need universal, accessible, regulated, subsidized childcare. That might have been me who said that. And everybody in the room said, yeah, no brainer, absolutely, absolutely. But how could we ever afford it? Taxes? Isn't it time that we had that pharmacare integrated in our health system? Look, but how could we afford it? We can afford the Alberta and the Canada we want. So, now, I want to talk a little bit about how come we've come to hate taxes, as most of us do, and as I heard in the phone-in with Daniel Smith show. I don't want to pretend there was some period in time where we just loved paying taxes. Oh, great, it's tax time. I get to pay my taxes. I hope I get double the taxes in the last year. I'm not saying that was ever the case. And we all know that when we go shopping, paying the bill is not our favorite part. And after all, taxes are the way we pay the bills for the things we do together that we could never hope to do as well or at all alone. Taxes are just the way we pay for the things that we do together. Infrastructure, healthcare, education, the things that we know we couldn't do on our own, right? But we don't like paying bills. I get that. We've never liked 500 years ago, Machiavelli told the prince, this is 500 years ago, it's a while back. I was just a kid. 500 years ago, Machiavelli told the prince, don't be too generous to the people, because then you'll have to raise taxes and they'll all hate you. So the notion that taxes are not popular is not a new thing. It's not a new thing. And somebody else reminded me, so I'll say it again. I often use in these talks my own parents as an example, because my parents were small business people. They ran a small business for years. And they did what is, I believe, obligatory by law in Canada. They complained about taxes. That's what, I mean, if you run a small business, then you have to complain about taxes. I believe that's the law. So every year, they complained about taxes. But you know, hold that thought, because every election, they voted for governments that kept raising their taxes. So they complained, it was an irritant, but they kept, you know, and you know why? They kept voting for governments that raised, because they knew what they were buying. You know, as I often say, when I'm a refugee. I brought my parents over when I was one, and because, you know, I saw that this would be the hot place to be, and so we came here, and for my parents, Canada was a miracle. They knew what they were buying. They were buying safe communities that they didn't take for granted. They were buying, get this, you know what we had in Canada when we moved here? Running water. Holy shit. They had You believe it or not, you could go to the washroom in our house, right? So for them, this was all like miraculous, that what they were getting. It was just miraculous. Later on, as they were building their business, they realized they were also buying some security in their old age. They were buying some, and they thought that, and when they talked about Medicare, and this is not a joke, it's not an exaggeration, my parents never talked about Medicare without preceding it with the phrase, the miracle of. And in their heavy, thick European accent, they would say, Alex, the miracle of Medicare. You go, you're sick, you go, they fix you, no money. It's a miracle, you know? So they grumbled, they didn't like it, but they voted for governments to raise taxes. They knew what they were buying. So what's happened to us? And there are a few reasons why I think we hate taxes. I'll just talk about three major reasons. Not two major, three major reasons. For one thing, we have become, and that's part of the success of the progressive state, we have become a consumer society. We are about consumption. Because the welfare state actually worked, many of us did pretty well, and consumption became an increasingly important part of our lives. But you know, public goods don't give us a positional advantage over our neighbor. If I want a positional advantage over a neighbor, I get a fancy car, a big one that just guzzles gas. I get four flat screen TVs. One of them is like 97 inches. 3D. 4D. What? He has 3D. I have 5D. So this is like a, what do you call it? The little treadmills that little guinea pigs keep running on. I mean, it's our consumption treadmill, right? And because it's really frustrating. I get the big car, and he gets a newer one, and she has a bigger TV, and we're dry. So we often choose shopping over the public good, because I mean, how many? You know, why do so many rich people want to privatize healthcare? So they can buy their way to the head of the line and get some positional value. How about valuing private school over public? There is no, you know, the beauty of public goods is they're homogenizers. They are the equalizers. We all benefit from public goods. Our general welfare is improved, but it gives me no positional value vis-a-vis my neighbor. But you know what? We don't have to be consumer first and citizen second. We could actually say, no, I'm a citizen first and a consumer second. I don't have to be primarily consumer and taxpayer. I could be a citizen working with other citizens, reflecting on our common citizenship and building the common good. Related to that, the second reason is that public goods don't come with a price. I mean, how much time have you spent when you go out at night looking at the lit street, wondering how much ingenuity, how much good thinking, how much planning, and how much cost went into making sure that street was lit? When you turn on the water, how many of you ask, I wonder what it costs, how much intelligence, how many good public servants, how many bright engineers, how much public money had to go in to make sure I could trust the water more or less, especially before austerity, I could trust the water I drink? How many of you ask, what does it take to make sure I can be pretty confident about the medicines I take? For the food I eat? How many of you ask? Because there's no price on it. And what's worse, most of us have never known another world where that they didn't exist. We take them for granted. It is part of the success of the welfare state that we take these public goods that previous generations, more willing than we to pay taxes, built. So what are we building? What are we paying forward? We're just taking this for granted. Isn't it time that we ask, what are we paying forward? That we're living on the shoulders of previous generations, more generous, more willing to sacrifice? No wonder our kids hate us. Not my kids. My kids love me. I want that on the record. But no. But no wonder kids wonder about the institutions and the extent to which they're, because we have stopped paying it forward. We're not even asking, what is our obligation to pay it forward? Everything that we built on the backs of generations more ready than us to sacrifice and commit to the public good. Surely it is our time, and especially mine, to hold the door open for the next generation and pay it forward. So that's the second reason. We take it for granted, there's no price on it, and we've got to remember the sacrifice and the taxes of previous generations that went in to build that, and we have to commit to leaving the world better off than we inherited it, and we haven't done that for this generation. We haven't made the commitment that the next generation gets a world at least as good and ideally better than what we inherited. In fact, we're leaving a bit of a disaster. But there's a third reason, and in many ways the biggest reason, and that is that government and public enterprise has been under systematic attack for three decades. We have heard over and over again that government's the problem and the market is the solution. What we need is less government, more market, less public, more private. The greatest success, in my mind, of the right has been to equate government with inefficiency and corruption, and to equate taxes, or to redefine taxes as a burden and a punishment. That is their greatest success. So when I'm in a forum and I'm talking about this, and I talk to chambers of commerce, and I do go to places, that's why I'm so glad to be here, but I do go to places that don't want to hear the message, and inevitably somebody says, oh, I'll pay my taxes, as soon as you deal with the waste. Right? Somebody just said something. Anyway, as soon as, feel free to interrupt, as soon as you deal with the waste, as soon as government's more efficient, I'll be there. Well, first of all, we massively exaggerate the waste. It's true that every government at every level gives us too many examples that fritter away not only the resources, but public trust. How much is a glass of orange juice? What about flying? And you know, we know all the stories. But in terms of the proportion of that to the budget, it's always way smaller than the Fraser Institute or the Taxpayers Federation makes it out. We have lived with generations of lies, often backed by big money, and it's time to call bullshit. Now, and I was... And, you know, we're all waiting for some leader, some politician to do it for us, but we do it at every dinner table, every breakfast table, when somebody raises this. You know, there are two examples I'll give you. I don't know. Am I way over? I'm good? Oh, great. I got lots of material. And a little soft shoe, a couple of songs. I think we can just... And then we hit the bar. That was for the bar? Get a grip. Let me give you two examples. Every year in Ontario, and I think in Alberta, there's a sunshine list of public servants that make $100,000 or more. Shame, $100,000 for people who are committed to the public service and a stronger Canada. Shame. $20 billion for a corporate CEO who drives his corporation to the ground, not a problem. Anyway, so every year they publish the sunshine list, right? And every year at that time, the Fraser Institute, a charitable foundation, not involved in political activities according to their annual charitable report, the Fraser Institute publishes in this sort of cloud of anger at these high-paid public servants a report on public service salaries. And they always report that the public service is getting more money than the private sector. They always report that. Now, there's two things wrong with their study, because I've looked at it really carefully. And the two things are, number one, it's bullshit. And number two, it's bullshit. So, First of all, if you look at the percentage difference, it's very small. Not statistically significant, but it is in favor of the public sector, but it's very small. And that's only for the bottom of the public sector. It's not true for the top of the public sector. At the top of the public sector, the private sector is way ahead. But the bottom, the public sector is ahead. And you know why that is? Because for years, for decades, we have had pay equity legislation that doesn't allow us to have the kind of pay gap that the private sector persists in having between the genders. Instead of complaining about the progress we've made, and by the way, even in the public sector, there's progress, more progress that needs to be made. The gap is smaller, but it's still there. Instead of complaining about the progress, the private sector should be emulating it. Instead of pointing to the public sector as overpaying, they should point at themselves for exploiting workers, for using contracts, and for persisting in an unforgivable gender pay gap. So, frankly, we instead of, politicians run around apologizing for this money, instead of apologizing, we ought to say this: what we want is wage-led growth. We don't want a race to the bottom. We want people with enough money they can actually buy the products and services that people are making. We want wage-led growth. We have to say that. So it's interesting that a blogger and journalist in Ottawa, Glenn McGregor, decided when all of this came out, the last report, because they've done many, he did a request, an ATIP request, because they're charitable, to Fraser Institute, asking them how many of their economists are paid $100,000 or more. And they answered. And the answer, their answer was totally reasonable. Just about all of them were paid $100,000 or more. They're highly educated economists. And they explained that obviously we have to compete for the very best talent. We have to retain the very best talent because we need really high level analysis. We don't care who it is teaching our kids. That could be anybody. We don't have to pay for that. We don't care who's negotiating our trade deals. No, it's the Fraser economists that have to be well paid. Hello, it's time that we said, I want to entrust my person, my kids, to somebody of excellence. And I want to pay what those people deserve. And it's frankly more than they get. And we have to stop apologizing for these public sector salaries. We have to be more bold. The accusation of waste, the accusation of corruption, we all want government. We all want government that's less wasteful. And we should hold governments to account for being less wasteful. We all want governments that are more efficient. We want governments that are more open and transparent. We want governments that make wise decisions. Nobody's disagreeing with that. But we shouldn't allow the Fraser Institute and our own anger at these examples of waste, we shouldn't allow that to lead to an exaggeration of the problem. The other thing that people raise with me is they say, well, okay. Hey, let me put a square bracket here. You know, I asked a private sector friend of mine about this issue of waste and how he would answer it. And he ran a bar. He ran a bar in Fredericton. And he said to me, you know, I have a real narrow profit margin in my bar. It's really tight. So I have to care about waste. And my three sources of waste are spillage, breakage, and skimming, both drinks and money. Those are my three. He said, and if I wanted to deal with that 100%, if I really wanted to deal with that, then I would use plastic cups. I'd only fill them a fifth, and I'd have video cameras everywhere, watching everybody all the time. That's where we're going, eh? The trouble is, he said, nobody would come to my bar. And having a waste-free bar that's also a client-free bar is probably not a good thing. And it got me thinking, you know, of course we want to reduce waste and make things more efficient. But all of these organizations are run by perfectly imperfect people. There will always be something we can point to as an example of waste. And yes, governments should be held to account, but we shouldn't confuse or assume somehow we can have a totally efficient, 100% waste-free anything. It's not in the cards, and it may not even be desirable. And efficiency, think about it. A hospital that runs at 100% efficiency would not be able to deal with the SARS outbreak or the inevitable illness of some staff. They won't be, and it just will ground people down and it will become less efficient. In the end, the quality of our service ought to be at least as important as the efficiency measures that we have made an obsession. The other thing that people point to is they say, well, yeah, okay, I'll buy all that. They don't actually buy all that, but they just want me to stop talking. And they say, well, I'll give you, there's stuff the government does that it shouldn't do. And of course, we all agree. Do we need stealth jets? No. So of course, that's true. That's absolutely true. The trouble is in this room, what don't we need? Some people will say we don't need welfare. Well, what's all this welfare shit? Some people say we don't need art funding. In a pluralistic society, we're going to always have governments that do some stuff we personally don't like. Suck it up. Get involved in politics and vote for the governments that promise you more of the things you do like. But understand, it's a pluralistic society, and there will be always stuff we wouldn't have chosen. The bottom line is that those cuts that come never make. If you were asking a businessman who has to be more efficient, here's an idea. You want to make yourself more efficient, here's your first step. Cut your revenue. Cut your revenue down, that'll force you to be more efficient. What businessman in his right mind is going to say, that's a good idea. I'll cut my revenue. That's what I'll do. That'll make me. No, this business of cuts driving efficiency, it never works. What happens with those cuts? Well, I'll tell you what happens with those cuts. In a word, austerity. So we chose it. We chose it every time we voted for a tax cut. We chose it every time we refused to ask the politician, when they offered us the tax cut, what are we losing for this? What is the cost of that tax cut? What are we giving up? We treated them all as, we kept choosing some change in our pocket over the public good. We chose it, and we can unchoose it. Now, it ain't easy to turn this corner because austerity is self-perpetuating in a variety of ways. It's self-perpetuating, first of all, because it feeds inequality. And it doesn't create inequality. Our market rules have created inequality, but it feeds inequality. We know that the consequences of austerity fall most heavily on the poor. We saw it on migrants, on refugees, on the most vulnerable, on prisoners. I mean, think about it. Prisoners, the easiest target to go after, have lost the meager wages they made when they built furniture that would have helped them reintegrate as law-abiding citizens, and we stole that away from them. What kind of country does that? We made a commitment, a whole party commitment in Parliament to end child poverty, and we're slightly worse off than when we made that commitment. Inequality grows. Do you know what proportion of unemployed people have access to employment insurance? It's in the 30s, and in cities of high employment, it's in the teens. That means we're throwing people into welfare and into dead-end circumstances and into the hands of those therapists that we talked about at the beginning, because austerity is toxic. So, as I said, we don't get to this trickle-down stuff. It's not wealth that's trickling down. We get trickle-down meanness. But there's an even more profound way in which the austerity feeds inequality. It erodes our redistributive tools. It erodes EI. It erodes welfare. It erodes those things that would allow people to break the cycle of poverty. So we have extreme inequality in Canada. $2 trillion economy and this kind of inequality. How do we tolerate it? And the extreme inequality is corrosive. It's corrosive. You know what happens? The people at the top, inequality is extreme, come to believe they deserve everything they have. They come to believe that they're there on their merit. They are the job creators. Don't tax me. I'm the job creator. We all know the job creators are the people who buy the products, the people who work. No, suddenly these people at the top, they're the job creators. They deserve, you know how in our lives luck matters. We all know how much luck matters until we make it, and then it's just us. No, there was no luck in this. I might have inherited $1 million or $2 from my dad, but Trump was on a talk show the other day. Did you hear about this? And he says, you know, I've had it tough. You know, I started with almost nothing. I got $1 million loan from my dad, and I was starting. What the hell is that? Hello. But the other thing is that when inequality is so strong, these folk can secede from society. They don't need the public services the rest of us do. They can't commit to the public services the rest of us do. They don't get it. They don't need Medicare. They can afford private schools. They don't need strong public school systems. So they effectively secede from society. And when the gap between rich and poor is so great, how could we ever find common interest? How could we ever define a collective good? But they also have disproportionate power. Money always talks, but within extreme inequality, money talks pretty loud. And money is louder than it's been for a very long time. You know, so Parkland Institute is asking you for $2 donations as you go away, and they're hoping for $4. Fraser's not worried about $2 and $4. You know, but money talks. So it's corrosive of democracy. So the people at the top say, why should I pay taxes? I'm the job creators. I don't need all these services. I deserve everything I've got. The people at the bottom don't want to pay taxes either because they think the game is rigged, because they say government's not there for me, that I have no options. So they don't want to pay taxes. So what have you got? It's self-perpetuating. When you have extreme inequality, nobody wants to pay taxes, and who can blame them? The first job of business is to reduce inequality and to make the reduction of inequality across generations, across gender, and across class as the number one priority. If we're going to restore trust in one another in government, we have to start with a commitment to reducing inequality and poverty. There's a second way in which austerity is self-perpetuating, and that is it starts a cycle of erosion and distrust. In the States, the Republicans call this starve the beast. It's got a name. So what happens? You squeeze programs. You know, no politician, not in the States, not here, has ever run on a campaign which says, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to kill Medicare. I'm going to kill old age security, and I'm going to drive tuition through the roof. That's not what they do. They just squeeze the program slowly and incrementally through the tax door. They squeeze these programs until we don't believe in the programs anymore. So you hear from Canada Post, the postage is going up, but home delivery is off the table. So you're going to pay more for less. And you say, I hate government. Why would I pay taxes? You watch CBC, and it just seems sillier and sillier because it's squeezed, and you say, who needs CBC? I have this image of somebody in traffic gridlock in Toronto, stuck in traffic for hours, trying to get home to her family, to her kids, breathing in the fumes of all of these cars, saying, God, I hate government. But it's years of failure to invest in modern transit and infrastructure that's causing that. But what happens is we lose trust in government, that we squeeze these programs and our trust in government's eroded. The government simply is not as good as it used to be. We wait longer and longer for health. We pay more and more out of pocket for drugs and health services. Today, we pay more out of pocket for health than we have from the beginning of Medicare. Tuitions keep going higher and higher. No wonder we hate government. So it creates this cycle of erosion and distrust. And so rather than paying the taxes that would actually rebuild the infrastructure and give us fast transit. We say, I won't pay pay taxes to incompetent governments. It also erodes politics and the quality of our democracy, because frankly, we start to wonder why government, why we should care about government, why we should, forget paying taxes, why should we even vote? If government's not there for us, why should we be there for it? And in the end, it stunts the political imagination. It makes it seem like nothing great is possible. So I would argue that we have the perfect 21st century dilemma, paradox. There are collective action problems, the things that we could only fix together, have never been more challenging. Climate change, inequality, intergenerational inequity, eroding democracy, never been greater, but our collective toolkit has never been weaker. So the question becomes, how do we find a new balance? How do we position ourselves to promote government that builds an economy that serves the many, not the few? How do we position ourselves to promote a public policy agenda that puts nature and people at the center, not on the periphery? How do we reorient politics that human well-being is more important than wealth creation? Well, that takes me to the beginning. How do you deal with new governments that may be more friendly? And I'm going to conclude with, the government is going to be as good as we demand it to be and no better. And the future is going to be as great as we're willing to pay for and no better. And so I was struck because it was the anniversary of a great singer, labor activist, who when asked about his coming death, said, "Don't mourn my death, organize." The theme, and that's become a theme in labor. That's become the constant theme in labor. When labor hits a wall, the answer is, don't mourn, organize. Well, I would argue that we're here on the flip side of that. We have governments that offer new possibility. Don't celebrate, organize.
Thank you so much, Alex. What a great way to get us started. I know that we have in the room and at the conference over the course of the weekend some 30 young people who are either current participants or recent graduates of the Next Up leadership programs in Edmonton and Calgary. I know for a fact that they all get the notion of the need to expand and move the Overton window, and the role that conversations like this have in expanding and moving the Overton window. And I think that's why we're here this weekend. So that sets the perfect tone for how we want to move forward. We do have some time for questions and answers, if you're willing. We have a very fun dynamic with microphones today. We had to kind of patch together our system. So what I'm going to ask is that you put up your hands. One of our mic runners will get a mic to you. And once you get the mic, I'm going to need you to turn it on. And then as soon as you're done asking your question, we need you to turn it off. Otherwise, you won't be able to hear the answer. So I'm going to start over there right behind you in the blue sweater. Okay, and let's take a few at once, and then we'll come back to the answers.
Hello, thanks for your speech. The thing they often complain about on public services is their pensions. You know, they have so much value in their jobs because of their pensions they have. But why doesn't that make the private sector and the private workers want pensions in their jobs? And we're losing pensions all the time in the private industry. And it just seems so ridiculous that doesn't happen.
Thank you. We've got another question up there.
Thank you very much for a wonderful opening discussion. I love that you used the term social justice and talked about the fact that we have to work on social justice. I go to a lot of meetings where there's industry people, and I don't want to condemn industry across the board, but a lot of people use the term, we need the social license to develop. And I wonder if you could say a few words about how you differentiate those.
And is there one more over here?
I liked your talk, maybe not as much as last year's. Chris Hedge was great. But my question is, first of all, I believe your whole argument is predicated on a faulty premise. And that faulty premise, from my perspective, is that if you don't have big government, neoliberal capitalism will take over. And that, as a socialist, a libertarian socialist, I believe in the whittling away of government to eventually get to a communist society where we can have abolished wage slavery and have no classes whatsoever, where we have an ethos of shared collectivism. I come from Cape Breton, where we hadn't had much money and taxes didn't really help us, but we had the miners' union, we had the steel plant union. You know, when you give in Tompkinsville was a cooperative. When you give the means of production over to the workers, you don't necessarily need taxes. So do you agree, or did you just leave this, the independent voice of the working class, out of the conversation?
Great, thank you, Alex.
But you know, Marx liked progressive taxes. Let me put it this way. You know, I've been trying to figure out how concretely change is going to happen. And it's not going to happen top down. It's going to happen community by community, and worker cooperatives and greater ownership of the community is a huge part of it. And Wolf has written about this, and it's a huge part of it. If I was to put it in simple terms, I think we need strong government to harness the corporate sector to serve nature and people, but we not need strong civil society to harness government to serve nature and people. And what's one of the difficulties on a bottom up of the anarcho-syndicalism of Chomsky, or one of the difficulties is there's massive differences in community capacity, and there's huge interference from the corporate sector. And you know, as we're building these little cooperatives and people are polluting and corrupting nature, I think we got a problem. So my own view is there's much merit in what you say, you lefty crazy person, but yeah, and I meant it as a compliment, but I hold that government's a huge part of getting there. You know, it's just a huge part of getting there. With respect to the pensions, I couldn't agree more that one of the techniques of this sort of neoliberal counter-revolution has been to divide us against each other. And the pension example is perfect. Instead of decrying the failure of the private sector to provide adequate pensions, because we've virtually seen the end of fixed benefit pensions in the private sector, or instead of fixing the Canada pension plan, so it's truly a replacement pension plan, we point to public servants whose collective bargaining has achieved the kind of pension we all deserve. And the last thing we need is a race to the bottom. And yes, it is a generous pension. But surely the solution is not to bring people down to the worst, but to raise people up to the best. With respect to social license, you know, it's a really interesting thing. You know, at Davos, the people who own the world meet every year to talk about the future of the economy. And this last meeting of Davos, they started with a discussion of the Endelman Survey, which surveyed trust, right? It's an annual survey of trust. What the survey has shown is a constant decline in trust. We used to trust our government. Now all all countries have low trust for government. But this year was really interesting. This is the first year where they saw a sharp decline in trust in the private sector. So, you know, government workers relaxed. We don't trust anybody. And this is a real, they're worried. These people are worried because they need social license. You know, there is no pipeline because they didn't get social license. Aboriginal people rightly hold a veto because they don't have social license. What they are realizing is that to save capitalism from itself, we better have some social justice. Now, they're not arguing because they're egalitarians. They're arguing because capitalism can't work when there's revolution afoot. That Canada, that in the end, they need some buy-in. And they're not, with the level of inequality and the level of environmental exploitation, they're not getting the buy-in. And it's a threat to the business interest. There's two ways of looking at it. We can look at it in our friend's way of saying, what will it take to replace this screwed up system of capitalism? Or another way is, how do you save capitalism from itself, the moderate and the more radical? Those are the two. The corporate sector is asking, how do we save capitalism from itself? There you go.
We can take some more questions.
Hi. I think I'm not sure whether I'm going to be a question or maybe even a bit of a dialogue with our gentleman over here. In my adult life, my brother has had to put his signature on the legal paperwork to try and save the resources of the Canadian Wheat Board that were sold, given away to somebody in Saudi Arabia to do with as they will. The Rural Electrification Associations have been disbanded. Our government services and telephones and all numerous public services have been destroyed. And I have seen this in my life, and I know it because it's taught to me from my parents and my grandparents, and it tears me apart that all the resources that my dad spent his life pouring into to try and build up the infrastructure. He has cancer, and he's watching his grandchildren looking to have to start right again from the very beginning to build all these things again. You know, when I look at the stories that come out of Syria, the only thing we're really missing is the bombing.
I'm gonna go up here now. I don't think that mic is on.
Okay. My question is about the role of the increased globalization of capital in undermining notions of governments as having responsibilities to people and undermining the notion of public goods and the notion of workers' co-ops and everything else. I mean, that how does this figure in too with the whole thing with taxes? I mean, that, you know, like even in the recent election, in discussing corporate tax, which is it was 40% when I was a bit younger, it's now 15%, and nobody wanted to raise it any higher than 17. So I'm wondering, you know, how we move beyond that kind of thing.
Okay, is there one more question out there before we come back? There's one down here, right at the very bottom. Oh, you got one up there? Okay. Is it on? Okay.
So in a room like this, we're all fairly well versed in the kind of things and the discussion that needs to happen. But when I go back to Calgary on Sunday, when I go back to work next week, I'm going to be encountering people who very much would never find themselves in this room and would never readily admit that they know me. But the fact of the matter is that they exist in large numbers in all sorts of places around the province, around the country, around the world. There's always those who are going to be the arch capitalists, the ones who are trying to take advantage of the system and take advantage of what we've created. But there's always those in the middle who kind of follow along with them. So my question is, when I go back to work on Monday, how do I talk about this to them? How do I can't convince them in one sitting, but how do I, what language do I use to help them open their eyes and see that there is in fact a different way, that there is in fact hope, and we can actually do these sorts of things if we try hard? Because as you say, they've been convinced, they've been beaten, battered, that, you know, there is no alternative. How do we re-spark that hope within people who long ago lost it, who would never find themselves here and are flailing?
I won't answer the tough questions. I won't answer the sort of long commentary because I think it was a heartfelt, important statement. I don't think there was a question, but I recognize the importance of what you've said and the suffering that underlies it. But there are two that were framed more as questions. I'll take those on. Perhaps the biggest change wrought by the Thatcher-Reagan counter-revolution was the elimination of capital controls, the encouragement of the free flow of capital. And this notion that free trade deals, so-called, and tax cuts constitutes an economic agenda. we have significantly, and the Americans in particular, have significantly developed policies that globalize the flow of capital, and we watched that play out in 2008. And yet, it has changed the game. It means that some things, like a carbon tax or a financial transaction tax, both of which I think we desperately need, and the closing down of loopholes and havens require international solutions. And rather than being the recalcitrant player, we ought to be a leader. So it's interesting that 13 European countries agreed to have a financial transaction tax. It was originally an idea that came from Canada, and we backed out. I mean, so are there ways of dealing with that? Absolutely. We also ought to ask ourselves, when tariffs are so low, that trade deals offer few trade benefits, what exactly are we doing with these various trade deals? And what we're doing is protecting ownership and the flow of foreign capital. These are ownership deals. They're not trade deals. These are investment deals. And we ought to be pretty wary and have the kinds of debates that, you know, somehow, somewhere in the 80s, we all became fiscal conservatives and free traders. It's time we changed our tune on both those counts. So, but we shouldn't exaggerate the room that we have. You know, so on corporate taxes, you're right that there are probably limits now if we don't work in a corporate way. But, you know, think of the takeover of Tim Hortons by Burger King. What was that about? That was Canada as a tax haven. Our taxes are so low that American corporations came here to avoid the horrible taxes in the States. Is that what we want? So we've got loads of room to have a tax advantage and higher taxes. We have loads of, so you're right that we can't be indiscriminate, that we have macro problems that we have to solve that limit our degrees of freedom. But we have loads of freedom. And, you know, people hate, you know, I stayed away for it on purpose, the notion of a sales tax, because I know in Alberta I may never get out of the airport if I raise the sales tax. But in the successful European countries, all of them have a sales tax more than double, triple the provinces that do have them. And somehow or other, their well-being and economy are performing just fine. So we have loads of room. We can afford the Alberta and the Canada we want if we're willing to pay. Now, how do we tell people this? I don't know. If I knew that, we would have progressive governments in every, I don't know. But I'm sincere when I say it is our obligation to provide our own independent leadership. We do have to call bullshit. And sometimes they don't like it. But if we're doing it at every table, when they say public servants are paid too much, you say, well, the evidence is that's not true. And you say it 11 times. When they talk about waste, you say, well, think of the waste that the financial meltdown and the unregulated private sector created. Think about the lost wealth that created. Think about the waste of Enron. Think about the waste of the market run wild. Think about the waste of the pollution that the free. You want waste. We're penny ante. You know, so yeah, I think there's an ant, but we have to stand up. We have to change the conversation. Somebody said to me that they were a little bit nervous that the first NDP budget was so timid. But what I really liked about the first NDP budget here was that I saw an attempt to change the language. I saw an attempt to say, we're going to protect public services. We're not going to go after teacher salaries. And if you want great change, you got to change the language. And that sometimes, you know, that means you're sometimes talking to people who are just going to be pissed off. And I can say with confidence that I've had that experience.
I'm going to take two more questions, and then I'm going to ask Alex to wrap up. I see one at the back corner up there.
No? Hi. Thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. I definitely support that we do need to pay more taxes and creation of public good. But I'm thinking by myself sitting here, will it actually change the system? I mean, the neoliberal system will be still there. We're just going to pay more taxes. We're still going to continue work as we are working, having the same values, destructing environments, spending lots of time overproducing and consuming stuff. It's not going to change our behavior, our vision of nature, culture, community, and so on. But I don't know the answer. On the other hand, we have like a transition town and eco-villages, which is kind of a hippie that left out the system. It's not a solution. So I don't know. What do you think?
Please go ahead and answer that one. Mine's actually fairly simple. Okay, so as a summary for the various questions that have been asked, would it be fair to say that one of the most important things that we as a progressive group need to do is to stay in the fight?
That was a great way. You should have ended the session, because that's exactly what I believe. That is exactly what I believe. That our job is to create room and pressure for governments to do the right thing. That when a progressive government says, I'm going to balance the budget at all costs, we have to say, wait a second, there are higher priorities. When our governments disappoint us, we have to push. So we even, you know, it was easy to push the governments we hated. We have to push the governments we love. In the horribly pessimistic, in my kids, by the way, and my wife, you just get unbelievably tired of my endless optimism that we can make a better world. They get mad at me. They say, oh, Jesus, Dad, you know, give me a break. But I actually believe that we can build the country we want. We can take the future back. The future can belong to us. That we don't have to give over our, delegate our future to the market. We don't have to get delegate our future. We have to get involved, but we can take the future back. Now, the taxes, that's just a, that's an opening gambit. It just enlarges our sense of what's possible. It, we made the rules that govern the market. We made the bankruptcy rules that give an advantage to the rich but don't allow homeowners to use bankruptcy. We made the trade rules, and we can unmake them. What's most frightening to me is that we treat the market as somehow natural and given. The market's there, some kind of natural God-given thing. God doesn't even like the market. Humans created the markets. Humans created the rules that govern the market. It's a human product, and we made it, and we can remake it, and we can unmake it. Now, I don't want to end with false optimism, though that is my temptation, especially after a glass of wine. But I was watching James Galbraith, the economist, progressive economist, on YouTube. Just yesterday, there was a live thing on YouTube. And he was talking about inequality and the economics of inequality. And it shows you what a nerd I am that that's how I spend my time. But in any case, I'm watching this, and somebody in the audience said to him almost exactly what you said. And he said, but look, it's, you know, why can't we be Sweden? I mean, even Sweden now wants to be Sweden because they've gone through a tough decade. And so he was asked, what made Sweden work? And his answer was 7 consecutive social democratic governments, not one budget. So yeah, stay in the fight, and stay in the fight for the long term. The right was out of power in the 60s and 70s, and they invested mightily in changing how we think. They invested in think tanks. They bought chairs of business schools and universities. They invested in the long term, and they created this mindset that we can't own the future. We have to invest in the long term, in Parkland, and CCPA, and universities, with the singular goal that we take back the future.
I absolutely love it when the speaker makes the pitch for me. It makes it so much easier. Once again, I want to thank Alex for a fabulous opening and a fabulous conversation starter tonight. We've got a little gift for you. I know there were more questions in the room. We've got a whole weekend to have these conversations. A lot of our speakers are here tonight and will be milling around all weekend as well. So please take the opportunity to have the conversations with each other and with the speakers that are here. Again, if you find yourself now inspired to come to the rest of the conference, you can still pick up a registration at the Parkland table in the lobby. Coffee and goodies will be on at 8:30 tomorrow morning. And we will get on our way with our first talk at 9 o'clock right here with Stephanie Bloomingdale from the Wisconsin State AFL-CIO. And once again, one way to make sure that we keep expanding the window, pushing the envelope, changing the language and growing the conversation, making possibilities, is supporting your local progressive think tank. Please remember to do so. Thank you, everybody. Have a good night.